Hi, everybody. Thanks very much for coming today. It's an exciting
unmuted
because after a long and exhaustive process, we have managed to figure out what is happening with the next generation of the LiveHelp program. A few weeks ago, we were able to make a final recommendation, which was that most programs should consider migrating from LivePerson, which is sunsetting its product, to LiveChat Incorporated, LiveChatInc.com, which was a tool that we found had all of the features that our focus groups had indicated were crucial, as well as a pricing structure that reflected the needs of many of the programs and an intuitive interface with strong and responsive customer support. So this is a tool that we think people are really going to like. And the next question, now that hopefully everyone has followed the directions in the migration guide that we've shared out a number of times to get a lot of their information out of LivePerson, is how to go about setting yourself up in this new tool and how to train your volunteer operators to use it. So that's what we're going to be discussing today, getting yourself set up in LivePerson, training your people, whether you call them operators or agents or however you want to refer to them. There are many, many different terms I've seen used over the course of the review we've undergone, and then how to manage your LiveHelp program, and finally some thoughts about the kind of reporting that these tools might produce. I'm going to talk mostly through the setup piece and to come back again a little bit in the reporting, but when it comes to training agents and managing your program, those are things that I'm much less involved with day to day, and so I'm very grateful to have Eve Ricaurte on the line. Eve is with Iowa Legal Aid, and they've been our partner for the TIG-funded research that's been going on for the past year or so to identify this next generation chat program. So I don't know if you want to say hi, Eve, but you'll be hearing from Eve in just a few minutes.
Great. Hello, everybody.
Awesome. Okay. So a number of you have already made it through these first few steps, but I want to just cover them quickly. Because I think that it's possible that those of you that haven't already done this have refrained from doing it because you'd like a little bit more explanation. So LiveChat Incorporated is located at livechatinc.com. There's also livechat.com, but that's actually a separate company that is not the company that we've recommended. I think we've been pretty clear about that in all of our communications. But because there's potential for confusion, I just wanted to repeat it. Signing up is pretty simple. You can go to livechatinc.com and click their sign up free button to get a 30-day trial. If you like the product after having tried it, it's easy to roll it into a paid subscription, and any setup that you do during your trial period should roll into your subscription with you, so you can do your setup as you evaluate the product. It's going to encourage you to install it on your website as a first step. You can skip that. That's not how we're going to handle this. So there's just this I'll do it later link in the lower right-hand corner. Once you get in, what you're going to want to do is add me as an agent, and then I will help you with the setup process. So to do that, you click agents in the top bar, and then you go to add an agent, and you add an agent. Here's the tricky thing with this. Every email in the live chat system is unique, and so I needed a way to have many, many different emails so that I could have an account on every single live chat program. The way live chat works is just like LivePerson, you're going to be paying for the number of people who are able to sign on simultaneously. So adding LawHelp to your account, adding that extra account is adding that extra username is not going to change your price at all. Although it may mean that, you know, if I'm logged in and I'm doing some work for you, you wouldn't be able to run your program because I would be occupying one of your seats. So we might have to coordinate with each other around that. But as I was saying, I need a separate email for every state program. And so the way that I've done that is you're going to add me with this special address, which is lawhelp.pbn+, and then you're going to want to use your two-letter postal abbreviation at gmail.com. So for instance, Eve added me to her account by adding lawhelp.pbn+ia@gmail.com. Once you do that, it'll send me an email, and I should be able to go in, do the setup, and then I'll send you an email back letting you know when everything is configured. And my first step will be to set it all up on your LawHelp development server so that you can preview what it looks like before you decide that you're ready to roll that out on your live site. So you don't have to worry that you request the setup from me and then it'll immediately appear on your page and you'll have people chatting you before you're ready. Once I have gone in and done my setup, you're going to want to, you know, begin the work of setting up the finer details. What I'm going to do is install the code on the development half of your LawHelp site so that you can preview it, set up the live help buttons that you're used to, do a little bit of configuration on the chat window, very sort of basic stuff, and then you're going to be in there dealing with the real details of your program. You do that by going to this gear icon in the upper right-hand corner, and then there's a lot of different stuff that you can do. I'm going to try to walk you through it, and I'm going to begin with the chat settings area. So when you're in the chat settings area, one of the things that you'll notice is this chat routing feature. This is a feature that I think Eve is pretty excited about. In LivePerson, I believe that individual agents had to claim incoming chats manually. With LiveChat, you're able to define rules concerning how many chats each agent can take simultaneously, and then the system will sort of automatically assign incoming chats to whichever person is least busy and has free capacity to take them. So this can sort of simplify the process of making sure that all of your volunteers are working consistently through their whole shift. When you add an agent, you'll notice down here that there's this area where you can define how many chats they can take concurrently. I think the default is 6, which feels a little high to me. Eve, you're handling about 3 at a time. Is that what you set yourself for?
Yes. I put 3 as my limit.
Right. But when you add that person, you can determine how many they take. And if you don't want to have chats automatically assigned to you, if your only role is as a manager for the program and you just want to be able to log in to oversee your volunteers, then you would want to click Don't Accept Chats for your own account. Because if you don't, then the system will begin to automatically send visitors your way as soon as you log in. Back in chat settings, the third piece of this chat routing system is that you're able to set rules about what happens when your agents are unresponsive or when your visitors are unresponsive. So if you have somebody who, you know, maybe they thought they could handle 6 chats, but they really can't, and so there are a couple of people they've been speaking with who have just sort of gotten ignored for a certain period of time, you could have the system automatically transfer that person to another agent who is open. If the visitor walks away from the computer but forgets to close the chat, to keep that chat from sort of appearing to continue being open and therefore prevent the system from assigning that agent a new visitor, you can have rules about when the system should automatically close chats or make them inactive based on whether any new messages are occurring in that chat. These features may be less relevant for states that are only using, you know, one seat and so don't have this ability to sort of bounce things between multiple agents, but they're worth keeping in mind. Also in chat settings, you are probably going to want to set up an archive forwarding email. You'll be able to see archives in the live chat website of all of the chat transcripts for your program. But if you want to also store that not in the cloud but in your local system, you can have it automatically forward any chat transcript to an email address of your choice or multiple email addresses. And so this is where you would want to do that. And finally, there's the URL rules section. This can be a little bit tricky, but I want to explain it to you so that you know whether it's something that you need and you can follow up with me and ask for it. In LivePerson, the way the system worked, you know, you had different skills, which was a way of dividing your operators into different groups so that they could handle things differently and presenting visitors with a different experience based on which skill they were assigned to. And we had to go and generate a new button code for every different skill. Live chat is a lot simpler. You can have the same button code anywhere you want. And then on the live chat side, you just write some rules that say, well, if the person, depending on what page the person is sitting on, when they request a chat, they'll be routed to a different department or a different group, which is the equivalent of a skill. So for example, I've done some setup here that says, you know, if the customer visits a page address that contains ES, then route them to the Spanish group. And so that means that if somebody is viewing a Spanish language page on my LawHelp site, they can click the button and they will be automatically sent to the Spanish language group of my operators, and they will have, you know, they can have a Spanish language window and Spanish language canned responses and all that kind of stuff. The other time when you might want to use this is if you had a partnership with a local court system, and so they were going to have a button for your LiveHelp program on their website, and then you could have a URL rule that would say if it's coming from, you know, this other website, not a LiveHelp website, put it in this different group because they need a different, you know, entry survey or something like that. Not everyone is going to need the URL rules, and if you need them, you'll probably want to speak with me about exactly how to set them up to make sure that they work. But I thought it was important to let everyone know that this is the strategy that live chat uses to separate people into different categories, which is a different strategy than the one that LivePerson used. I think it'll make it easier to construct new groups because, for instance, in that court system setting, you could just forward them your button code. You wouldn't need me to generate a new one for you, but then you'll have to set up a little, you know, some rules on the back end to make sure that everything flows correctly. And then here, you know, since we're now talking about groups, it's worth mentioning where they appear. In general, I find this interface very intuitive, but groups are kind of hidden. You have to go to agents. So where we added an agent before, you can click agents and then toggle over from agents into groups, and then you're able to add a group. You know, right now this is set up with English and Spanish. You can add groups for whatever you want. And then once you have these groups, you can assign different agents to different groups. And I think that's why they store it in the agents area. Another thing that's a little bit less intuitive as far as, and the next thing that you're going to want to tackle in your setup is you're going to want to go to chat window and then look at the language area. This area is misleading, and I want to call attention to it because it does much more than just set the language for your chat window. It's also where you can customize a lot of key pieces of information, like what the title bar of this little window says. So it says, welcome to live chat. You could change it to say, welcome to live help, or, you know, legal assistance, or whatever it is you want it to say. You can also change a lot of different values in here, like what we are calling the person in this window. So, you know, here we're calling them a visitor. You could call them, you know, a client, whatever word feels best to you. You can customize the first message that will automatically appear when they're connected to an agent. All of that is set through language, so it does a lot more than just change the language of the chat window. Changing the language of the chat window won't be necessary for most programs, which I think have a single language group, which is English. But you'll notice that up in the right-hand corner, if you're trying to run a multilingual program, you can select a particular group, and then once you select a group, you can set language settings that are particular to that group. So I was able to take my Spanish language group and make sure that the chat window would have its navigation text appear in Spanish. This tool will not automatically translate. So if you type into the Spanish window in English, it will appear for the person that you're speaking with in English. It won't automatically translate it for you. That's a feature that they're considering, but they don't have it yet. But you can have the chat window itself present in many, many different languages. After you move through language, then you'll notice here you have the chat surveys. And so many people, I think, had built these out to a great extent in LivePerson. And pre-chat and post-chat surveys are available in LiveChat as well. An important difference is that where LivePerson allowed you to have logic inside these surveys, LiveChat does not. What that means is, with LivePerson, you could structure your questions so that they would say things like, in the first question, what legal issue are you facing? And then, if the person chose domestic violence, you could tell the survey, oh, if they make this choice, have question two say this instead of saying this, and you could have it sort of branch. LiveChat does not have that feature. It wasn't a feature that was identified as crucial by our focus groups. If you want to recreate something that is like that, it's not exactly the same, but if that's really something that you want to try to achieve with this platform, I would suggest setting up multiple groups and using the URL routing to do this instead, because you can have different pre-chat surveys for different groups. So, for instance, to use my example, you could set up a group for domestic violence survivors and then have anybody who was viewing your domestic violence page and clicked the chat button routed into that group, and then their survey would have a bunch of questions that were specific to that issue. Again, it's not the same behavior as what LivePerson had. But if I were determined to get that kind of branching logic into my surveys, that might be one way that I would attempt it with this new product. After you finish building out your surveys, you're going to want to check the queued visitors area. The title doesn't make it entirely clear, I think, what this is for, but it's basically where you can set a hold message. If you have the system where all of your agents have a certain number of chats that they're able to take simultaneously, and therefore, if everyone is chatting with the maximum number of people that they're allowed to chat with, and a new chat comes in, this is the message that your visitors will see, letting them know that no one is available to talk to them, that they need to wait a few minutes. And you would just click this message button over here on the right, and it will let you change this text to whatever you want. And then finally, in the chat window area, you're going to want to take a look at the ticket form. A ticket is essentially a way of saving a chat issue for later. And there are two moments when this comes up. The first one is if you have somebody click your chat button while no agents are logged in, while your program is not operating, you can choose to allow them to leave a message just like this, and you can manipulate this and change the questions and what information they have to leave and that sort of thing. But you can choose to let people leave you a message that will then be stored in the ticket section of the LiveChat website, and Eve will get to that, I think, when she's talking about managing your agents. If you choose not to use this, then they'll just be told that the program is offline. But this is a way for them to contact you, even if there are no agents available, and then potentially you could have your agents look at the ticket area and see if there were any issues that they needed to respond to. As part of their day-to-day work, and Eve will get into that more later. As long as we're talking about ticketing, I just want to mention the second use for it, which is that a chat agent, while talking with a person, can click this More button, and they get a number of options that Eve will talk to you about, but one is to create a ticket. And you might want to use this if, for example, you have an agent who's talking with a person and the conversation is lasting a while and that agent has to leave, his or her shift is over, they need to be somewhere else. And so they can transfer the chat, but that will only work if you have multiple seats and you have another agent that's online to receive it. If there's nobody online to receive it and your new person won't be able to log in until your old person logs out, you can preserve that issue by turning it into a ticket, and then when Agent 1 logs out, Agent 2 can log in and pick up the ticket and respond to the person. And then a final note on ticketing, jumping out of the chat window area down here to ticket settings, is just to notice that by default, LiveChat has the system set up so that if you're using this ticketing feature, it will email your visitors 24 hours after their ticket is closed, asking them to take a feedback survey. My guess is that is not a feature that many of you will want. And so you'll probably want to jump down here and uncheck this ticket rating request button. How am I doing on time? Okay. Moving on. Engagements covers all of the different ways that your LiveChat that LiveChat will call attention to itself. One is this system called greetings, where you can set rules. So if a person has been sitting on the page for 20 seconds, maybe they're confused, in which case you can have your chat window automatically pop up and open with an invitation for help. On a mobile site, I should switch out. On a mobile site, that having this window pop up takes over the entire screen. So instead, it has a little message like this. And that would happen after 20 seconds, or if they've come back multiple times, it'll sort of suggest that maybe they need to talk to someone. That may be something that you want, it may be something that you don't. This is where you could control that. Eye catchers let you basically add an image to your little chat window so that it will look more eye-catching. I think they're a little weird. I wouldn't use them personally, but to each his own. I will say also these don't work very well with the way that we have LiveChat set up by default after I run through your setup, because what I've done, at least for this initial phase, is make sure that things look and feel exactly the same from the perspective of your visitors. So the buttons that you'll see are the same buttons that you have right now with LivePerson, but clicking them takes the visitor into a live chat window instead of a LivePerson window. So we can skip eye catchers for the time being. And then finally, the chat buttons, which are the sort of traditional way of engaging with people that you're used to from LivePerson, these are the two buttons that this button 3 and button 4 are the two buttons that I will create in your account as part of my setup, and they drive the work that I do on the LawHelp side to make the buttons that look and feel just the way the old LivePerson ones did. Because these buttons aren't complete in and of themselves, and they're just little pieces of information that I am picking up and working with on the LawHelp side, if you make changes to these, it will have unexpected effects. So for instance, this button says Live Chat Online. The button on your site will never say Live Chat Online. That's just a message that I use to read on the LawHelp side to determine which text to send. So for the time being, at least, while we're using a strategy of having the buttons look and feel exactly the way they used to, if you want to change the text of your button, you shouldn't do it here. You should write to me and let me know what your button needs to say. And that's a compromise that may fall away as people begin to experiment with having buttons that they've created directly in LiveChat instead of trying to recreate the experience of LivePerson. Okay, almost there, guys. Canned responses. Canned responses are the equivalent of canned chats from LivePerson. They work a little bit differently, though, in that where LivePerson let you sort your canned chats into menus and submenus, LiveChat has this shortcut system where you create little shortcuts for your various canned responses, and then an agent can call up the canned responses just by typing a hashtag into the chat window. You can recreate, I think, the experience of menus and submenus that you had in LivePerson by having all of your shortcuts follow a particular format, which is that they should have the menu name and then a period and then the submenu name. And when you do this, you'll notice that you type the hashtag and you'll see all of your different categories, but as soon as you begin to type the name of a particular menu, the list will shrink to show you only the shortcuts that begin with that menu name. So it'll essentially be a list of submenus. And if you assign the same shortcut to multiple canned responses, you'll see there's this number over here to the left. That's the number of responses that match that shortcut. So I've put two responses into the same shortcut, criminal links, and then when I click that shortcut, I get a list of the two responses that match, and then clicking one of those will paste it into my message and send it. So with a little bit of thought, you can recreate your menu submenu structure that you're used to from LiveChat if you want to. But I think in general, the shortcut system is easier to use because your agents will be able to call up these canned responses without needing to take their hands off the keyboard and use their mouse. The other thing that I'm very pleased to be able to announce about the canned responses is that thanks to the LiveChat API, I've been able to come up with a lightweight little tool that can automate the process of migrating your canned responses from LivePerson into LiveChat. And the way that works is hopefully everyone will have saved an XML file of their canned chats from LivePerson. If you haven't done that yet and you're interested in migrating those over to LiveChat, you should follow the migration guide now, before the 31st. Once you've done that, I'm going to share this link around. All it does is it opens an email that has a very specific subject line. And you're going to be sending an email to support@lawhelp.org with this specific subject line. And you'll just attach your canned chats XML to this email. Eve, have you gotten a response yet, or are you still waiting?
I did get a response.
Excellent. So I'm going to throw it to Eve, and Eve can tell people, can you just show people the email that you got after you sent in your canned chats file? Oh, and you'll have to share your screen.
Yep, I just pulled it up, and now I'm going to show my screen. All right, I have multiple screens. Hopefully it will show.
Yep, that's the right one.
Okay,
Yep, and so then you can, yep, and so if you go ahead and click that link.
The opening sheets?
I think they'll both work, but why not? Opening sheets sounds good.
Oh, okay.
Yep, and this is not a spreadsheet.
Well, let me go back and click the other one.
Oh, you know what it is, though? So you, oh, no, you're signed in. Right, so you sent the email from a different account than you for Ricaurte. Is all the,
oh,
is all
the, yeah. Google is always an issue for me because I have my laptop set for my home email address.
Okay, gotcha. So this is a small hiccup. I'm gonna take possession back then.
Okay.
Just, so I can show things on my end. But I'm very pleased that you were able to receive the email. That's exactly what should happen. And then when you get it, and you follow through with it, this is, let me show you what you're going to see. So you'll see, here we go. This is what Eve will see when she sorts out the permissions issue. Because it'll send this spreadsheet to the same email address that you used to email me or to email support. And that will be the email that has permission to view it also. It doesn't put things into live chat right away. Instead, what it does is it has this canned chats tab. You can go through and you'll see it's taken Eve's canned chats from LivePerson and it's done what I suggested, which is put menu name and then a period and then the submenu title. And then here are all of her different chats. So you can go through and make sure that all of these shortcuts look the way that you want them to, get rid of or edit any messages that you aren't interested in keeping. And then once you're ready, you'll have to provide your live chat credentials. And then you can just come up here and click Migrate Chats. And once you do that, they'll all be added automatically into your live chat account. The instructions for how to get your credentials and put them into the spreadsheet are all listed in the instructions tab with screenshots. So hopefully this process will be pretty easy. One thing that this tool does not do at the moment is it doesn't let you route different messages to different groups. All of these will be added to live chat and they'll be added directly to your default group. So for people that only have a single group in live chat, this isn't a problem. If people have want to set up multiple groups in their live chat program and they have canned chats from LivePerson where they have different chats for different groups and they need that feature, it won't be too much trouble for me to add that to this system. But I didn't want to go ahead and do it unless people tell me it's something that they need because this isn't a tool that we're going to keep around for a long time. It's a disposable thing that we're just using to get people out of one product and into another. So I want to spend a minimal amount of time on it. If you need that grouping feature, you can either speak up now or email me afterward. But that's how the migration system is going to work, ideally. And obviously, if things go wrong, I'll troubleshoot them with you. But I'm confident that we'll be able to take that XML file and move all of those chats over in bulk to the new program so you don't have to retype all that information. Also, immediately after canned responses in the agent tools area are tags, and I want to take a moment to talk about tags, even though I have to throw to Eve soon. Tags are basically labels that you can create and that your agent can apply to chats. And these are important to mention, I think, because LivePerson had a feature where in addition to the pre-chat survey and the post-chat survey for visitors, which LiveChat has as well, there was a post-chat survey for agents, which LiveChat does not have. But I think that you can use this tagging system to do a lot of the same stuff people were doing with their post-chat agent survey. You can remind your agents that they need to tag their finished chats, and then you can provide the tags that will basically let you collect the same sorts of information from them that you might have collected in your post-chat survey. So for example, if you had a post-chat survey where you asked your agent to, you know, record what legal issues came up in a particular chat so that you could then break down your reporting to see what legal issues are being discussed. You would just create tags that corresponded to each of your legal issues and then remind your agents that they needed to tag their chats with the relevant issues as each chat finished. Last thing, there is, and this is just an FYI, there's a security feature that's available. It's turned off by default that would let us lock your LiveChat account to only a particular domain. So for instance, if you're lawhelp.org, you could make sure that only people that were on lawhelp.org would be able to be to send you chats that you would respond to. This is to prevent people from, you know, taking the code for your button and installing it on their own website and then taking advantage of your program, you know, to get their own answers. I decided not to enable this as part of my basic setup for a couple of reasons. First, we've never had a problem like this, even though LivePerson didn't offer this protection. And additionally, when you're an agent, if you're looking at an incoming chat, you can see what page the person is on. So if it becomes a problem, your agents should be able to tell relatively quickly that there are people that are chatting them who are not on your website. And when they let you know, then we can always turn this on after the fact. And third, I'm just worried that if we set this and then we forget that it's something that we've done, we could be in a situation where at a certain point somebody wants to share the button with another website, like a local court site, and then we install the button on the court site and it's not working properly and we can't. And we have to remember what we did and dig it out in order to make it happen. So my decision is that as my default setup, I'm going to leave this off and only enable it for people if and when the issue that it's designed to prevent actually becomes a problem. So that was a lot of information, but it's all recorded, and that was the setup piece. And now for training your people and managing your program, I'm going to throw things over to Eve. Eve, feel free to talk, and I'll keep moving the slides as you go.
Okay. And do we want to use the chat screen? Or we can just move through the slides, but we can also...
Yep, no, you're right. So I'll make you a presenter. Let's do that.
Okay, so this is actually, we have no chats. I don't know, Sam, are you if you want to chat me, or should I chat you?
Well, let's have somebody in the audience chat, because what's going on right now, you're logged in as an administrator, and I am logged in as an agent.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we want to send them the link in the chat room?
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
So what we've done is we have a demo set up on Eve's development site, so the LawHelp Iowa development site, which is just dev.lawhelp.org/IA. I've just sent out the link, so if somebody's feeling brave, please visit, and you'll notice that the button should look the same way the regular LivePerson button does, and you can go ahead and chat Eve.
So you'll see right now, if you're seeing that I have no chats, and but I can look at visitors. So I've changed my screen to visitors. This was similar to, you know, we had that button in LivePerson.
I think that you're logged into your live chat as opposed to the demo that we set up.
Hmm.
Yeah, I'm going to take it back because there is an incoming chat, in fact.
Okay, for some reason it didn't. I logged in as the login you gave me, but it just went to mine.
Okay, well, so here it is.
Okay, let's see. Where did I have this one?
And the reason why I knew that, even though this wasn't on my screen, is that I could hear it saying to me, incoming chat, with a little ringing. Before I help you, I'm going to blow her off for a moment. Is this how you're logged in, Eve, this email here?
Yes.
I clicked on the link that's there, the dev one, and I'm in there, and I don't appear in the queue yet. This is Brian.
I'm sorry, Brian. What have you done?
Oh, I clicked on the link that you guys sent to the chat, the devlawhelp.org.ia, clicked on the need for information chat. I don't appear in the queue yet either.
One sec.
Okay.
Well, Jillian is appearing in the queue. I think that issue is more. So you clicked here?
Yep, exactly.
Okay. Have you entered your name and email?
Yep, and now it has LiveHelp support is up. It says hello all delivered.
Huh. That is frustrating.
And yes, it's odd because when I logged out as me and logged in as the login you gave me, but oddly enough, it's showing up on my site instead of the development site.
Okay. Oh, so Brian is chatting you.
Am I showing up on the live site?
You may be on the live site. We didn't want to use the live site because we didn't risk it.
Obvious reasons. Yep.
Exactly. So this is dev.lawhelp.org/IA.
Yep, and that's the site I'm at.
When I click this button here, I get routed into my dummy account on the webinar tab. Here's Jillian and here's me.
Huh?
I'm not
this
sure what
happened. Jillian got routed correctly. You can demo the features with Jillian.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's strange that you aren't in here, Eve. It's still insisting that you're offline. So my guess is that your system automatically remembers your login and password, and so it's very helpfully logging you into.
I did have as a choice. There. Oh, now you're here. Okay. Well, Sam, maybe I'll have to. I guess we can either go to my site or I can just walk people through this one.
I think we should stay here because I don't want to have a webinar where we're working with the risk of having actual people show up. So you can call out the features that we're seeing and I'll put them out on the screen.
So for those of you who've had live chat programs before, if you're not new to this, you just need to remember that to have a list of websites and links to other places that to send visitors to. One of the things that you see on the screen here are the three circles, and you'll see I discovered that these are the visitors, and they change in color from green to red. And they'll change order also. So one of the things also to remember is you can see where they are on the map. And you might notice that a lot of your visitors are not in your state. And before you send them answers about programs or articles, you might want to ask if they're looking for information for your state. So
I want to call attention. They change order based on the people that you've been ignoring. Right.
Yes.
So I haven't talked to Brian recently. I can see that there's one message here that I haven't even read yet, so I can go here and see what he's doing. But then once I respond, I'm sort of not in danger of losing him anymore. So he becomes green and he moves to the right so that I'm always sort of on the left looking at the person who is probably the most frustrated with me at the moment.
Yes, exactly. And then once you've answered them all and nobody's waiting for a question, they are green again. So one thing to train your agents or navigators on is to make sure they click on the circle and look at what the question is. They go away to get an article and then they come back. The order of the chat may have changed, so they need to make sure they're looking at the right chat when they put an answer in. You may come back to the screen and find that you've gone to a red one who's waiting for an answer. So that's one of the things we found. Then we use that location map. Another thing is that if we scroll over to the right, you can see the website they entered on or the articles they've read. And you can also see if you hover. This is a little different. You have to hover over the. There you go. You hover over the button, the browser button, to see what browser they're using and what platform. So you see it's Firefox and Windows. This is important if you're going to you want to train your agents if they're going to send A2J interview links to someone and yet they notice that someone is on a mobile device, then that you know that might not work if they're on A2J Author 4. They're not going to be able to use that interview on the mobile device. So that's pretty helpful. In that, you can click on that button. Well, you've already showed the More button, so I don't know that we necessarily need to do that. We can just see if you go to that More button in the chat. And you only see this in the chat. So this is where you can upload a file for them. For example, if they are asking about a form and maybe you have a form that's not on the website yet or there might be a paper application or whatever you need to upload for them. If your state is doing attorney advice and you want to send them a form they can fill out, you can upload a form, which is something that we weren't able to do in our uploaded file, which is can be any sort of document. Also, we already talked about creating a ticket and transferring a chat. And then this is where stopping the chat and banning the visitor are that we had in a different place in LivePerson. Then Sam already walked you through going through the tickets. So if we go from, I think, does anyone have questions about this chat window? Okay. So Sam, if you go to the visitors tab button we've seen, if you want to go to the archives.
Sure.
So and there are none. Oh, maybe we need to create a ticket.
I'm in yours as well.
Oh,
and
good.
In yours, I am set up to not accept chats.
Okay.
I should be. Now I am.
Okay.
So I can go here. So here are your archives, which is a better way to do it.
There we go. Excellent. So here are the archives for Iowa Legal Aid. And this is essentially the chat transcripts that we had in LivePerson. These are in the archives. You can sort them by date. You can sort them by agent. Unfortunately, we only have one agent. One of the defaults is the rating. They have a plus minus, you know, good, bad, or by tags, which is, you know, you're going to enter your tags. I have a couple of tags in there. I have a few, so I just have started using those. I don't have very many chats under each one, but that lets you find chats that might be on a particular subject. Also, you can go into that archive, and if you click on one of them, just click on one, opening one.
Okay.
You can go in there, and I believe there is a button to, yeah, you can tag it after the fact. And I don't know if you can actually, after it's archived, can't do it as a canned chat, but that's one of the things that that I guess we didn't do in the chats. Once you're in a chat, if we go back to the live chats.
Sure, one sec. Nope. Sorry, guys. I just have too many things going on. Here we go. All of these live chats.
Okay.
In addition, so you know, you can hover over it to see, but you'll also see. So this is my phone, and you'll see this mobile icon here, and that's telling you that I'm on a phone. So yes, create a canned chat. Brian needs some love. Oh, or it's been closed due to inactivity. I've lost all of these people. Oh no. Okay. Yes, talk me through this.
So once you're in a chat and you've sent an answer, there will be an icon on the right side in that chat by your answer, and you can save that as a canned chat.
Ah. And this is an important distinction. In LivePerson, your chat timed out for an activity, Brian and Jillian. you know, and that's the setting that people can change in their setups. But if it's inactive for more than a certain number of minutes, it'll just close the window.
That's interesting because it doesn't seem to notify the end user that they've timed out. I'm still able to type things into the chat.
Oh, that is interesting. Okay, so maybe we should set a very high threshold for that.
Well, and it says timed out, but it doesn't close the chat. That's on another screen. We can address that. Now, it doesn't close the chat until the agent clicks on. It says, this has timed out. Do you want to close this window?
Right here. All right, this is what I was responding to. I can't respond. My only choice is to close the window.
And I can still type things into the chat. It doesn't tell me it's no longer going to you.
Well, Brian, if you type that in, we might be able to see one of the other features. What happens if
I'm still typing in the chat right now, and it's not appearing up here.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, because I've closed it. So that's an important thing to keep track of. Oh, but I am getting a notification. Okay. Ah, here we go.
So now I'm back.
Yep.
So, Sam, do you want to show how the previous chat is?
So that's actually. Right, so it appeared as closed. You guys didn't see because it happened on my other screen, but I had a little notification box pop up from Brian in the lower right-hand corner, and when I clicked on that, it brought him back to life.
Yes.
But let me go ahead and save a canned chat here.
Okay.
And this is a crucial difference. LivePerson, only admin-level people could create canned chats, but LiveChat, any agent can add to your list of canned responses. And it's relatively easy to do from within the window. So you're going to want to, you know, either tell people never to do that or train them about what your system is and how they should label things.
Yes, and I think I forgot to add this as a screenshot to our presentation, but it's here recorded, so this is good for you to see because this is all of the agents can add canned chats, and they can go in on the settings and look at the canned chats and change them. They don't have access to all of the settings if they're not an admin, but they can work on the canned chats for you.
Mm-hmm. They can also create new tags. Those are the two things they can do.
Yes, they can create new tags as well. So that gives them more tools than they had before and might be more helpful, save admins a lot of time. We've got, I think, everything we need from the chat. We've looked at archives. Let's go to tickets.
Also, the system has its own little tutorial that's built in. So this is the first time in this dummy account that I've clicked on tickets. And so it gives me, you know, a built-in walkthrough. And you'll find that it's full of helpful features like that.
So if you're in tickets, it will show you anybody who has left a message. For example, on Iowa Legal Aid, we let them leave messages at night, and then in the morning when I come in, I just click on tickets, and it will show some of the questions that have come in overnight. This used to be in LivePerson, they came in as emails, and this is really an effective email system because it doesn't have to be routed to any one person. Any agent can log in and answer respond to the ticket. Then the visitor gets an email back with the reply. So it's a good system that way. It's what you can transfer a chat to the ticket system. You can also just go in there and create a ticket to do a follow-up email to someone who has chatted. And this is the create a ticket. So it's nice because you can use this as an email system without giving out any one person's email in your program. It's a good way to communicate that keeps everything on your website.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see. The tickets can be tagged as well. So if someone asks you a question in an offline, you can tag the tickets and use whatever tags you have available. So that will merge those questions and answers with whatever else you have.
Mm-hmm.
Then, yes.
Well, I was just going to say, we're getting toward the end of, of time. I just want to make sure.
Let's go to reports.
Sorry?
Staffing prediction. report's probably the most important thing.
Yep.
Okay, so these are the reports. If you are an agent, you see somewhat fewer of the reports. You see them, but you can't export them. If you're an admin, you see a little more here.
Right, so here's what agents can see, and it's going to be specific to them, I believe. And this is what admins can see.
Yes. So you have reports. You can pull them by seven days, a different period, or a custom period. You can pull them by agent and by tag. So if you want to know how many chats you got about, whatever topic it's in there, then and then you can, if you are the admin, you can export those to, which if you click on the export button, it will export your reports to you in the same way that you used to be able to pull them up on LivePerson.
Right. You can save them. You can save them all as CSV here. This feature here, where you can set up a recurring export, so sort of every, periodically, you'll receive them as an email. So that you'll be archiving all this stuff on your own machine without having to worry about it in a spreadsheet format that you can mash up with other data later. This is specific to the enterprise level product. So my guess is that most people are going to be either considering the team product, which is off the top of my head $33, and the enterprise level, which is $50. And the real difference is this advanced reporting feature here, as far as I can tell. And my recommendation to you would be to go with the enterprise, at least initially, because both of them are substantially cheaper than LivePerson ever was. And I think it would be better to purchase this feature, discover that it's not really something that you're using, and downgrade, rather than try to save upfront and end up in a situation where you aren't getting the information that you need out of it and you really wish you had been.
Yep. So probably the last thing we want to show you is back in report, or go to reports, and we will do the prediction, the scheduling.
Okay.
So I think it's in chats where the staffing, yeah. So if you scroll down to staffing prediction, this is a new feature that we didn't have in LivePerson that will, it gives you a prediction of how many, you'll see this says two agents are going to be needed in the peak during the period. And then there's a drop-down arrow where you can choose the last 7 days and choose. For example, you can see that on Mondays, maybe it was heavier, that for next Monday, you might need heavier, more. Monday, you might need one agent. So this is a very good tool for managers who are scheduling various agents how many agents or seats you need in any one period within the next, based on the chats that have come in over the past few weeks.
So you'll need to use it for a few weeks before it begins to see any patterns.
Yes. Yeah, you can see it started to already pull in some data for us. And then the other thing that I wanted to point out is the agent's handbook is available on the LiveChat Inc. website. And I think that's in the, if you go to the top bar, there's next to subscribe now, there's a question like, go the other direction. There we are. The knowledge base. If you click on knowledge base, the agent's handbook is in that knowledge base if you haven't subscribed. So if you get to that address, you can see it explains how to set it up and how to run your program and do some things for the knowledge base without actually being signed up. Yep, there we go. So that gives you a good overview.
I just wanted to pause here for a second. We do have a couple of questions in from the audience. One is, asking whether the migration guide will be available to folks that was referenced at the beginning of the webinar, whether that will be sent out to folks.
It's been sent out 3 or 4 times already over the listserv.
Okay.
I can send it out again, but that's been available for about a month and a half.
Okay, and then the other question was whether you could reiterate whether you recommended the enterprise level or what level you recommended.
Sure. My instinct is to go with enterprise. Enterprise is $50 a month if you make an annual commitment and $59 a month if you go month to month. You would save about $20 if you go with the team version, or $20 a month. So you would save a couple $100 if you go with team over enterprise. But both of them are drastic savings over the live person, which was $159 a month. And so my thought process is there are some additional features in the enterprise, specifically the more advanced reporting tools that will let you get more data out of the cloud, out of live chat, stored on your, in your personal system as spreadsheets without having to think about it. And it may be that you'll do that, and in 6 months you'll discover that it's not really a feature that you need or use very often, in which case it's easy to downgrade. But that seems like a better direction to go in than purchasing something that turns out to be too small, and moving in the opposite direction. And given that both of them are substantial savings over the status quo, I don't see a reason to try to stretch for the extra $200 a year when you're already saving, over $1,000. That's my personal thought process. That said, I'm less familiar with the day-to-day operations of everybody's organizations, and it's certainly your everybody should make their own choice. I'm just trying to give you the insight that the key difference between the two to me seems to be that export feature.
Right, and Iowa chose the enterprise also. We have a limited amount of use right now, but we're looking at expanding and having, right now I'm the only agent, but we're looking at expanding and adding more agents, and so that reporting feature would be mm-hmm. better for us. And then we'll review it at the end of the year and decide where we want to go from there.
And the staffing prediction feature that you're enjoying a lot also is an enterprise
level.
Yes.
Yeah. So that staffing prediction alone, if you have multiple, if you have more than one seat, especially, and if you have multiple, navigators and or agents that might want to increase to a second seat, that will help you make that decision.
And this is a great example of why you shouldn't take my advice at face value, because I looked at this list and said, oh, the reporting is the key thing. Staffing is also an enterprise, and it wasn't until I was working through this stuff with Eve that she said, the feature that we really need to talk to them about is this prediction feature.
Any other questions for us?
As a reminder, folks are unmuted, so feel free to speak up or also write into the chat.
In addition to all of the reporting that we've discussed, LiveChat can integrate out of the box with Google Analytics, which means that you can use all of the reporting tools that are available inside the LiveChat website, but you can also look at your LiveChat stuff inside Google Analytics. If you go into behavior and then events, you'll notice that once things are set up and running, live chat is an event category in the same way that clicks on links to external websites or downloads of your resources are event categories in your Google Analytics view. And so this event will fire every time somebody clicks your live chat button on your site, and Google Analytics will record a whole bunch of information about that, like the page that they were on when they did it, and various other things. And so you can go in here and look at your instances of live chat events against any other information. So you can see, you know, what breakdown of people were coming from a mobile device versus a desktop device. You can look at it against the new county data that LawHelp began pushing into Google Analytics this past January. You could ask questions like, do people who have a live chat conversation view more articles on average than people who don't? You can do a lot of really interesting things now that your chat statistics are combined with your general website traffic statistics in this way.
Sorry, Mary, I see that you had a comment. I just wanted to make sure that it looks like this was a repeat of a question that you had asked before. Mary, I don't know if you're on the line.
Hi, is that Eve? This is Mary.
I'm here.
Hi. I just wanted to know if Sam was talking earlier about the different membership levels.
Yes.
And I think I heard him say that he recommended the enterprise level for the reporting capabilities. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
And I think Eve would recommend it also for the staffing prediction feature.
Yep.
Oh, that excellent.
That was the feature that I found most helpful.
Okay. We were thinking about going with the team level, but I think we might reconsider that, you know, just because of this webinar. So thank you.
Yeah, and I think if you you have multiple agents, so that staffing prediction would probably help you a lot.
Cool, thank you.
Okay. If nobody has any further questions, I think that we can wrap this up. Obviously, there's a lot to absorb, and there are a lot of choices that individual programs are going to have to make, not only about what level they want to purchase in this product, but how they're going to set up their different features. And I'm happy to be available to people as they try to figure out what these features are, you know, how they want to accomplish that. So this is not the end of the conversation. I just want to reiterate to everyone that's on the line. Hopefully, everyone is aware of this. There's been a lot of messaging about it, but May 31st is the end of LivePerson. On June 1st, your LivePerson account will no longer work. Your LiveHelp program will not be able to help people in LivePerson. And so you're going to want to get your crucial information, your canned chats, your stored reports, your transcripts out of LivePerson before that deadline comes. And you're going to want to work with me to select and set up either live chat or another chat solution of your choice in advance of that deadline so that your program doesn't get interrupted.
Sam, this is Mary again with Minnesota Law Help. Mm-hmm. We're planning to go live with live chat next week, probably Wednesday or Thursday. So I'll be in touch with you via email, but I just wanted to mention here that you know, I'm happy to talk to anybody that's trying it out. We have our state law library partners test driving it. Our staff has already been doing it for a couple of weeks, so we're feeling in good shape to go ahead and switch over next week, and we're really excited about it. But I would love to keep in touch with anybody about what they're experiencing, how it's going for them, etc. So feel free to email or contact me. That'd be great. Thank you. And Sam, you have been great. Thank you for this webinar today.
Sam's been great. I think, Jillian and Sam, I think the LiveHelp email listserv, is that still up and running? So people could. Yeah, so that's a great way for us to all stay in touch and ask each other questions.
Just had a quick question from Margaret in Oklahoma. She asked, Eve, did you say you have a training PowerPoint we could use?
I have just this PowerPoint from this presentation, and I'm happy to, you know, to share that. There is the handbook. There's a lot of training built in as you go.
Right.
Anytime you're not in the chat window, but you're in settings or the knowledge base, live chat pops up an agent who will help you find the answers. They're very responsive, and it's very helpful.
Right. The knowledge base is this life preserver thing here. And then also, right, as Eve was saying, there's this contact us button here. And then you can use live chat to chat with the live chat staff. And they are I've found them super responsive and very knowledgeable. And so this is a great way to get your questions answered. If reading around isn't helping you, or even if you feel like you don't have the time to read through for an answer and you need something fairly quickly.
Yes, that's what I found. I've been looking. I searched the knowledge base, and I'm in a short time frame, and I just type the question into the agent on live chat, and I get an answer immediately.
Yeah, and I think Mary would agree with this as well. One of the things that this product over LivePerson and LivePerson Success or LiveEngage, one of the major ways in which this stood out is that it's much more intuitive to use, and the technical support is a lot stronger.
Totally agree, Sam. Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm here in Michigan with a question.
Mm-hmm.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So I manage the LiveHelp program, and we recently changed the sort of account that we have, and so they have informed us that the end of live help will not affect us in the same way. I think, I guess, it seems like from the business model point of view, they're trying to migrate people onto their new platform, which was a part of the change that we made in order to have a floating button. So we have the little chat icon, but whether you're on mobile or the... And as soon as we did that in November, we noticed a huge jump in traffic, so we've been pleased. But I agree, the customer service, even just trying to figure out what's happening as of May 31st to our account at this point, took four agents, and three times I had to give them my account number, and, you know, so that's not great. And managing the predefined content, which we also have in English and Spanish, is pretty clunky. So I'm going to bring this back to our team. I am not the decision maker about these things, and I wasn't even aware of the pricing. That this is obviously so much more affordable. But in terms of Spanish language, or, I mean, I saw that you can create the Spanish groups, and I know that you would then, I guess, just have to program hashtags to Spanish language options. Is there any other functionality for, because sometimes what we end up doing is that English-speaking agents can't help a Spanish speaker because we title the blurbs the same, but then if you go into the Spanish menu, you know, it'll say whatever, custody order, and then
so
we kind of work around that because we don't always have a Spanish agent available.
Right. Theoretically, yes, you could have the same sort of system where you would have canned responses that you had translated into Spanish, and then you could select but you could have English names for all of them, so your English operators could use them.
Mm-hmm.
You may want to look at the other product that we've recommended for people that have sort of more sophisticated and involved needs is called COM100. COM100 has a feature where it will use Google Translate to automatically translate whatever people are typing. So if you have a Spanish speaker on your site and that person types in Spanish, An English agent will be able to read that message in English, and when the English agent responds in English, the visitor will see it in Spanish. COM 100 is not as intuitive as LiveHelp or LiveChat, but it's a lot more intuitive than LivePerson. The big stumbling block that prevented us from, the reason why that's not for everyone mostly is that COM 100, you pay for each user account that you create.
Oh, okay.
So where LiveChat works just like LivePerson, you pay based on the number of people who can sign in simultaneously. But then if you had, we could have 200 usernames because we have a ton of volunteers and it wouldn't affect
right.
our pricing. New
that's
York,
not the case.
That's not the case, right? To give you a sense, though, so New York decided to go with COM 100 for some of these sort of advanced, they have the most complicated setup of any of the sites in our network. Is what they wanted to do. They had to purchase purchase 40 accounts in order to do that because they wanted a separate account for each volunteer. Those 40 accounts cost roughly the same amount as they were paying for the current LivePerson product for their three seats. The way it worked out is it's about a 12-to-1 ratio after you go through the haggling with them and you get the nonprofit discount. So in other words, think about the number of seats that you have on LivePerson right now. If you have sort of more than 12 times that number of usernames, then it's not cost effective to move to COM 100. But if you have 12 or fewer usernames for each seat you're using, then 12 to 13 is the break even point.
I see. Okay.
But we have some people in our network were using 20 plus accounts or 20 plus usernames for a single seat, so it didn't make sense. As well as about the floating button. The floating button is one of the default behaviors that you can get from LivePerson, from LiveChat. So here's an example of their floating button. You can also have a floating bar. If I were going to work with people on sort of a next generation presentation of this tool on LawHelp, I would encourage them to use this button because it's actually very similar to what you see right now. It just serendipitously, it looks a lot like what we came up with when we created the new mobile responsive design. So if you look at, let me go to Iowa. Oh, what a terrible moment for this to happen. Here we go. So if you look at, this is dev site, so it's not going to be there. Life is fun.
If you want to go to michiganlegalhelp.org, you would see the way that
I'm trying to show you our floating button. So when you're on when you're on the mobile site now in our mobile responsive design, that's the button that we came up with for our for what happens because the sidebar disappears, so we can't have our sidebar button anymore, the traditional sidebar button. And so instead we have this floating button. But what we could basically do is take that concept and have it just always appear. So instead of a sidebar button, the easiest transition and the one that I would probably recommend for the LawHelp Network would be to use this theme in live chat and have a button like that floating in the lower right-hand corner all the time instead of only on mobile devices. For the time being, to sort of ease the transition, I've done some work on our end to make sure that the presentation of LiveHelp looks the same as it used to on the LivePerson, but I think that going forward, it's definitely worth exploring that. And I bring it up now just because you said that you migrated to LiveEngage because you wanted the floating button. We're not using it in our default setup right now, but it is a feature that's available in LiveChat.
Yeah, we did that mainly because we know from Google Analytics that almost 60% of the users are accessing our site from a mobile device, handheld or tablet.
Yep.
And yeah, it was just, yeah, it was the chat option was getting lost. So
right. Yeah, and we hadn't even been looking at that feature in live chat at the time we did this, but we ended up with a very similar sort of decision when we rolled out our new mobile responsive design this spring.
Well, thank you very much for all the work that you've done on this. We don't, I guess, have the deadline as a hard stop in just a few weeks, but the ease of use seems to be far superior.
Yeah, well, I'm very pleased that you came out. Yeah. You know, thank you for coming.
Oh, sure. Yeah, this is great.